Welcome to the Foolish Kitchen, once again outdoors. It's too hot to cook in the house, so cook outside. Oh. And I warned you when I brought home that lobster pot what would happen. Today is 3rd of July, tomorrow will be the 4th of July, and this is a traditional New England clam bake. Well, it's technically not baked. Generally, I'll explain how to do a bake, but this is going to be just a lobster boil with other things. But how can I just say they followed me home? Well, I found this pot in Goodwill for a couple of bucks. It was $3 or something. Usually they're like $5. It's unmarked. I don't think it's new, but I don't think it's terribly vintage. Didn't have a lot wrong with it. It had some limescale. So I just scrubbed it out. Now I'm going to go fill it up with water. And it had no damage. I was shocked. And unlike the granite, the speckleware, blue speckleware for canning, and the black one that they're selling now, this weighs a ton. I filled it from the garden hose. I don't know if there's little dead gnats or something in there. I'm eating something out of the ocean. I don't think the gnats are really the biggest problem. I filled it halfway because what I'm going to put into it is going to raise up the water. So hopefully that won't take too long to boil. First thing I'm going to do is shuck the corn. It's only mildly windy, so I have to keep checking the gas. Some people will shuck it in the grocery store. They're picky. Leave that on. That's your handle. Don't leave little things on either end. You're gonna get butter all down your chest anyway, so don't fret. Put the wrapper on it. But when I was a kid, we used to sit out in the back stoop of the house, just peel all the corn every day. Most of my grandparents down there. Technically, you're supposed to go out and start the water boiling and then go pick it and peel it and put it in the water before the water gets to boiling. All right, so that's going to fit in there just to swell. That's my big garbage bag for the day. And, can't really overcook the corn, so that's not a big deal. We're getting there. Traditional New England clam bake. You dig a big pit, you build a fire, stones, put all your clamming and everything on top of it, in the pit, cover it with seaweed, you've got a fire under there and you're filling everything in and you put seaweed on top of it, and then you put stones and you cover it up with a big blanket, and then you come back a couple hours later. The heat from the stones and the fire that had been there will cook everything. Because none of the stuff is particularly hard to cook. I mean, the hardest thing might be potatoes. But in lobster boil, I think we're getting there. We don't need a rolling boil. And besides, it's kind of pointless. This is going to kill anybody who was in there anyway. So a lobster boil is basically this: you put everything on the pot. And sometimes people put crabs, you put a Old Bay seasonings, you can put whatever you want in the water. You don't do that. It's kind of an adulteration of the guest of honor. So these are guests of honor. And like I said, I'm gonna try to throw them in there, close my eyes. I'm committing, lobster genocide, but somebody's gonna eat them, might as well be me. And since we're here and we got you. Now, you gotta watch the lid, because it's so easy to let it boil over if you're not watching. So now we gotta come back to a simmer. Okay, while we're waiting for things to come to a head, shall we say, in the pot, I'm gonna have some appetizer. These little cherry stones. This will show up in another video. It's a clam shucker, I believe, is patented by a fella from Connecticut. There are three or four patents for similar items that use a fulcrum and a lever and a blade. The one that's being marketed right now has got a bad rap. This one I like a lot. I've only had it a day. But for people who have a problem gripping things, I think it's these knees. So put my victim under the guillotine, and the idea is to get started in the I need my glasses. My hands aren't going to be underneath. Started in a groove, or as close to a groove as you can get, and then just use the fulcrum to start it up. I don't expect this to go all the way down because it's being held in a groove. So I still have to come in with my trusty Morty the Knife Man. Loosen that up. Yeah, I can do this with one hand. Lots of practice. Checking. And that one. As long as you've got it in a groove. Really, all it had to do was start it for you and get that. Still have to come in with the blade and loosen it from the shell. Some people put lemon, some people don't put anything. This is, I mean, if you've got a right pocket knife, you get the tiny little Tabasco bottles. I don't know what they had with them before they had Tabasco. To me, without it, it tastes funny. I like to start it best looking groove that's there. Boy, am I very glad I spent $2 on this thing. You do lose some of the liqueur, so if you were you're gonna have some sand. It's life, it's beach food. If you were gonna use this to shuck a bunch of clams for another recipe, say fried clams or clam chowder, where you wanna keep all of the core, just keep it on a clean plate and let the liqueur build up and then sieve it through a cheesecloth or something thinner, like even a paper towel, anything, just to get the sand out of it. But anything you make, sand is going to be at the bottom. So just don't drink the bottom of the chowder. Sand. Now, I don't want to bring them all out of the cooler, cuz I want them to be unsuspecting, not know. So the other ones in there, they think it's like the claw from the Toy Story. And I did see some bad reviews saying it doesn't work on oysters. No, it can work on oysters. They have a completely different cell structure. You heard me. Shell structure. The shells are, one is laid inside the other one. So there's no way for it to be at an angle. It needs to be perfectly aligned. You gotta eat them at home. Put them in the freezer. A couple of minutes later, they'll all be relaxed and opened up and easier to start. Either that or they'll close up tight, but you have a better shot. It's got a, you might want to take a detail brush just to get your, oh, this one's going to be an interesting one. You might wreck this one. Cooler. I mean, you probably crush it, but I don't want to have that many shells in my to dig out. Yeah, loosen it from the shell. Get the foot. You'll see me doing the other video, just giving this a waterproof coating because it needs one. Not a lot of bugs out right now. So we've got our, everybody's been, they've been dead from the moment I put them in, so they literally would die instantly. They have a nervous system, which is very primitive. You know, if you want, you can, most places you buy them, they will steam them for you. You know, my attitude is, if you're willing to eat it, you should be willing to kill it, right up until the point of bacon. I think if I had to kill and see my own bacon, I'd probably not have bacon anymore. I don't have bacon that much. That was my rationalization. I don't have it that much. But what am I trying to do here? Yeah, the corn is underneath. It's really hard to overcook that. I mean, you're cooking these guys for like, I'd say 8 minutes, 10 minutes. Not really that much longer. I mean, it's four in the pot, so I mean, you know, it's going to be probably longer than that, 12 or something. To me, I always kind of judge it by the color and the wiggliness. You know how you do that with a lobster, with a chicken? Okay. So we're gonna do two things. One, I'm gonna put some steamers on top of that, and I'm gonna steam them by putting them on top of the seaweed. They're gonna steam instead of boiling. Places I go with steamers, they're lowering a basket into a, yeah, we almost lost the camera there. They're lowering a basket into boiling water, which is not really steaming, it's boiling. These are hard to judge. They're all gonna, they know, their shells don't close completely anyway. So, but, you kind of figure, as long as they're tight, they're good. If they're sprung and they're not tight, if they bounce open, don't take them, don't eat them. You're gonna get one bad one in a batch. So, and no, I didn't bother washing them. Oh my God, I didn't rinse them. Why? They're gonna get boiled. They'll be fine. And the other thing I want to do is, I don't normally have butter, but I don't normally have steamers. Here's some butter in a saucepan, which will probably turn up in a different video. And I'm gonna do this. And hopefully that should work. I think everybody's ready to party. It was melting on the top, just not as fast. I probably should have put it there the whole time, but I wanted to keep opening it, screwing around. Yeah, these guys are all cooked. I mean, they don't take much. I mean, there's not much to them. It certainly is going to stay hot for a while, so I'm not too worried about anything. Just want to get, don't want it on top to be juicier. And our butter is almost completely melted. That'll keep on melting. What I'm gonna do is put you guys here. Probably should take them out, make it easier. These are hot to handle, so I'm gonna let them cool off. Everything's hot to handle. I just boiled it all. I know I'm only one person and I made so much, but A, the clams won't last. Those are dinner. And I'll probably have one of the bugs. And the other ones are going to get shelled. And then I've got some lobster rolls I want to make. And the only way to make anything is if you have leftover lobster, but I have never in my life had leftover lobster. I mean, literally, I could eat my weight in them and have one Easter. I got like a 4-pounder in my Easter basket. Nothing else, no chocolate, just them. Him, but that was fine. Yeah, see, this is the color you want. I don't like to eat them that big anymore. The small ones. The bigger ones are the ones that actually lay all the eggs. So, eating the big ones, shame on you. Anybody who eats a lobster that's older than they are is committing a sin. Put the big ones back. They're the ones that have the most babies. You have a big lobster problem like that. So, if you were four people, you know, you'd have a lobster and corn. I mean, if you weren't from Maine. If you were from Maine, you'd have all of this to yourself. Generally, that's why you have two lobsters in it. You go to restaurants and stuff. And then you'll have other stuff to fill you up. But generally, if you're having lobsters with other people here in Maine, outdoors, it's not in a restaurant, it's buy as many as you can afford. They will all get eaten. There will not be any leftovers. Eat as many as they will allow you. And steal some if you can. I think we got all of it, everybody. And now there's not much to do with that broth. There's just way too much sand in it. You'd have to wait till it tomorrow. If you're going to do lobster stew, generally I would start all over again and just take the bodies and screw those. You might be able to save some of this and spin it out. I just find it never really works. It always tastes funny because all the shells, it just has too much other stuff going on. And there's our butter. I don't generally eat it on lobsters. That's for the clams. Dogs are at it again. Okay, we've got our bivalves for another bivalve picnic. And we have our pot au feu, New England pot au fire. Maybe we'll use that as a video title. So these guys are steamer clams. And a way to eat them. I always find they need butter. Not like mussels. I don't really need butter for mussels. You got a belly. You've got your foot. Your neck, as people call it. And then you've got this connective tissue. And it's all good eating. Some people don't like the texture of the belly. Some people don't like the texture of the neck. and there's this skin on the I'm not gonna eat. There's a skin on the neck, on the foot that has to come off. You don't want to eat that. That's kind of icky. And I always find I need them to go in here. You can, if you want to, load it up. And especially if you don't want to get a lot of butter on your chin, you can load it up and then eat them like escargot. Mm. Damn, I forgot how good these are. Why don't I like these? Why don't I eat these anymore? I don't want to eat mussels. I don't know why. I just don't need all that fuss with the lemongrass and stuff. Mm. I still find a little sand in them. It's just the nature of the literally beast. I'm gonna give some to the dog. She's not gonna eat it, but it'll keep her busy. Yeah. Little dog chewy. I've got butter on it. She'll like it. She had a. I tried to share my pork bun with her from the. And I gave it to her, and she just looked at it, and then she tasted it and realized it was pork, and it was like, oh, I want more. But she didn't want any part of the bun. Yeah. She stopped begging for what I'm eating because she tried it and said, nah, I don't like that. So. By the time we finish these, lobsters will be cool enough to just disassemble. This is the time of year when they have soft shells, so they charge more money for them because in the colder weather when they have a hard shell, before they've molted, it weighs more. So you're getting more shell, less lobster. But spring, early summer, all the season for lobstering, you're getting lots of new shelled lobsters. There's a lot of lobster in there. And because the catch is based on the distance between the eyes, the width of the carapace. It's like from here to here. So they measure that with a little device and whatever. So they used to just catch them when they were a pound, but now they're under a pound. These are all 3/4. I mean, I love lobster so much, I moved to Maine. But then I can't afford to have that often. If you're a lobster fisherman, I'm interested. Guy, girl, I don't care. Give me a call. If you're bringing that baggage, I will happily do your laundry. And other things. But I love them so much that I would, in a more sensible universe, like to see them skip a year, don't harvest any for a year, and then let them repopulate. But you'd have to, somehow the lobster fishermen would have to make a living. But that's really what we need to do. Give the population a chance to come back. I wasn't gonna buy 4. I'm gonna buy 3. One more now. 2 for lobster rolls. The guy who was selling them to me thought I was a tourist. He's like, oh, you can't make lobster rolls with that many in them. Because I was like, oh, I get 6. He's like, you can't do that. And I'm like, yeah, I kind of can. So he basically bullied me into another one, but it was like, I should have just told him to shut up. I said, dude, I live here. Because the way I do them, which I don't think it was the way I'm going to do a video on them, is I, instead of using the hot dog rolls, which I abhor. I hate hot dog rolls. I don't even use them for hot dogs. I use the conies, the side split. And then I like the potato rolls. They have a lot more structural integrity. So you can load them and they don't fall apart on the way to your mouth. And I don't really want an overabundance of lobster, because a lot of people, especially tourist places, a lot of restaurants, they give you an overabundance of lobster because they know you're going to leave the roll in the bowl on the plate. They know you're just having a lobster salad with in a bread holder. But if you use potato rolls, then that becomes part of the yummy. And I've got some leaf lettuce growing in the garden just for that occasion. I grow lettuce just to make lobster rolls, no other reason. And basically just chunk it all up, take it all out of the lobster shell, chunk it all up. Enough mayonnaise to give it some cohesion. That's it, no more mayonnaise. If you want to get exotic, you know, maybe put a little bit of garlic powder in the mayo, you know. Maybe a little bit of chopped, you want to get really, you know, fancy. A little bit of chopped parsley or chopped herb or something. You don't have to have any of that. It's not the point, but don't go to town on a mayonnaise, because that'll just ruin it. But you just need enough to hold it all together. Get it in the bun. And so you line the bun with the lettuce. The reason the lettuce is there, and we're not talking iceberg, it has to be whole leaf. The reason that's there is to keep the bun from getting soggy. And that will hold the roll together. So you got a leaf lettuce, and then you've got your lobster roll, and by using the potato side sliced, to me it's like a slider. I'd rather have a lot of those than one big one. There was one place, what was it? It was Joe Fish, one restaurant I had. I ate a $25 lobster roll. I just went there because I had a raw bar and I could get as many, you know, cherry stones and clams as I could possibly eat. And I got the $25 lobster roll once. It was nice, but you know, I could have bought that much lobster roll. Shelled lobster for that price. And we still have some butter in case we want to dredge something else. I mean, I didn't want to melt too much because once it's melted and it has all this stuff in it, the only thing you can do is put it into a chowder. Melt right away. If you're going to make a chowder or something else, it's going to be something fishy because it's very fishy. Okay, I need that weapon. I'm going to need this plate. I don't like to make mess because then it gets all over the table and the buggies come. I don't need you. I don't need you. Right with you. And I don't like to use a nutcracker. I've never used a nutcracker in my whole life. I think I learned how to dissect a lobster before I could walk. But I don't tend to use it on the soft shells because it will crush the meat. On the hard shells, you kind of need it to break in if you don't know how. If you don't know where all the joints and all the good parts are. Take off the rubber bands. Back in the day, they didn't have rubber bands. These were put on with a little staple gun. Back in the day, they shoved little wooden stakes right in the joint so the lobster couldn't open its claws. When I was very little, my then father, he worked at a grocery store, and they did not have a way to keep lobsters, the tank, going over the weekends. So every Friday night, they bring home lobsters. And no, I won't, even though they don't need them. But so to us, it was just like normal course of business. It's like, what do you mean this is? Because back when lobsters were plentiful and there were many people in America to feed. It was peasant food. It was food because you could go, you know, anybody could go pick it up. And as the lobster populations diminished and it became hoity-toity, you know, things change. But like I said, when I was a kid, it was just, we had lobster all the time. I didn't know it was a big deal. But it was because they would truck it in, and the lobsters, the tanks, they didn't have the tanks that were like aquariums. So, if you didn't, they didn't sell that lobster that day. SOL. So So lots of guys who worked at, if you worked in the meat departments, you ate rather well. No, you've got to eat your whatever I gave you. A lot of people, we eat that. That is the liver, and it's the tastiest part. Yada yada yada. I don't eat it because it's green. It's a personal preference. This is the blood, which is coagulated. That stuff you want for a lobster stew. You absolutely want that stuff for lobster stew. That's going to make your lobster stew. Go away. You've been very lucky about the bugs. Usually that stuff, what's in the tail, comes out. I want to make sure you get that. I worked in a restaurant once, and I'd see people order lobster, and because they're wimpy, they would order baked stuffed lobster, and it would be, you know, they don't boil them, they just kind of kill them with a knife, and then they open them up, and just as they are, and then they fill them with Ritz cracker stuffing. Ritz cracker and flavoring. I mean, it was just the most pointless food on the planet was this baked stuffed lobster, because generally they will eat the tail and the claws, and then they'll poke around in the middle, and that's it. And they would send the whole damn thing back into the kitchen with uneaten. I mean, there I used to bring home the now the spine, the dark ridge up the spine is the intestinal tract. So usually it's clean, usually especially if it's fresh lobster. If it's been sitting around a tank, that's gonna be empty. So that's a good sign that it hasn't been sitting around in a tank. So there's a little bit of meat there. Take that. Thank you very much. Now between these ribs, they're not really ribs. It's the cartilage that holds this guy together, because he has an exoskeleton, just like Iron Man. I'll take some of that blood. I'll take some of that. In between them are these little tiny bits. And the people who the reason they charge $25 to $35 to sell you lobster meat is because they have to go through this, get as much of the lobster meat out of here without licking their fingers, and that's really hard to do. So you want to just go and get those tiny little bits of meat, but you want to get them because you just paid for them. I mean, hell, people buy the freaking lamb chops and they're only about the size of a half dollar. I don't understand. It's like, oh, thank you. I don't need that. That's just showing off. Yep. And then there are these gills, the fuzzy parts that they use to filter water. That's their gills. Those are fuzzy things. But they're not gonna kill you. You just don't eat them. Now there should be a little tiny lump of meat at the head of the leg, like the shoulder. Should be there. Should be a little tiny lump of meat there. I want that too. And as the legs go down, there'll be a little bit of meat here, a little bit here. So sometimes people will just squeeze it with your teeth, like you're squeezing a toothpaste tube. I'm gonna cover that. The flies have found the corn. Oh, and there's a little bit of meat there. So it depends on how big the legs are. If the legs are big enough to pick out, if you don't like that texture between your teeth, you know, it's fair enough to not eat the legs. But that's really what separates the men from the boys, and the girls from the other girls, and the women from other women. You're gonna break it up and use it like a straw. I mean, it's just like sucking the head out of a crayfish. Exactly the same. That's a good flavor, tiny bit of meat, and the feeling that you just haven't left anything on the plate. I mean, the guy was saying, oh, you're not going to get enough lobster to make lobster salad out of... I'm like, I can get two lobster rolls out of that easily, because my lobster rolls are yummy. If you had a crappy lobster roll with, you know, white bread hot dog rolls, no, the lobster is a star. Not part of the ensemble. And if you don't want to make this much of a mess, you can just shove this whole thing in your mouth and chew on it. Depends on what, you know, who you're with. Usually you just eat this as you go along, but if you have leftover lobster, not that I ever do, you know, this is nice. You put this in a little casserole. You can make a little Newberg sauce, which is just a white sauce with, you know, with the lobster butter and everything. I think a little cayenne and maybe lemon or something. But then you just heat this up in a little casserole. So that might be something to do. Lobster ravioli, another interesting thing. I never had leftover. I know how to make those things. Why bother? This is like the perfect food. You boil it, you eat it. The end. It wouldn't be better if you're sitting like on the dock. So just take it right off the boat, put it in a pot. Let's see how that corn is. Probably a little. Oh, this is a super sweet kind. And you could put butter on that too. I'm not really gonna need it. Sometimes these super sweets, they don't even need to be cooked. That's about the only thing that genetically modified corn is good for. It's just like it's super sweet. And it doesn't taste like fish. It does not taste like anything. It does taste a little salty from the seaweed. Because we didn't put any salt in the pot, we just put seaweed. But it doesn't taste like lobster, it doesn't taste like clams. Corn has such a strong flavor. It's a little, you know how your fingers get wrinkled? It's a little of that. But it's also something you can leave it in the pot in the hot water until you're ready for it. I think the thing is, once you've got the bib going on, you can make a bib. You're committed to the mess. Sometimes you go someplace, they'll have red potatoes, or if you're really lucky, they'll have like linguiça. They'll have like a Portuguese sausage in the water. You want a cured sausage because you want it to stay in one piece after it comes out from being boiled. Something like a chorizo. You get that in there, in the lobster boil. It took me too long to get to these. They're a little cool. Not that that's a bad thing. Hot, cold. I'm fine. I cannot wrap my head around lobster in mac and cheese. Or lobster with cheese. Alright, the flies have found us. I don't know where they were before. But that just doesn't even sound appealing to me. I mean, I can deal with lobster ravioli because the ricotta is so mild. Okay.
And now, if you're sitting around people, you casually look to see if there's something you forgot. And there is. I forgot that. Missed it. But you casually check all of the insides. Make sure there's nothing you've missed. And nothing you forgot. And then you look to see if there's another lobster somebody didn't eat. But thank you for joining me. The flies have now joined us. So we're going to make all this go away. Who is off the picking table? And I'll see you next time. Thank you.